nods of approval, either that or freezing again, one way or the other. But we'll make it through that, not a problem. But good morning, everyone. And I want to thank you for joining us this morning again. If you haven't met me before, my name is Steve Knoll. I'm the executive director of TMA Bucks, and we're the nonprofit transportation management association that serves all of Bucks County. And first and foremost, I want to thank McMahon Associates, Eric Roth, Bill DeJeffrey for joining us this morning, and Anton Kuhner, who, even though he's not here, has worked with us in setting up these virtual sessions, and also Nicole Kelleher, who's joining us this morning from the Automotive Training Center. They are our generous sponsor. So before we get into the meat of things, just a few items of information to share with you. Certainly 2020 has proven to be a very interesting year at TMA Bucks, particularly. This is because, and as if you joined early, you heard us discussing how all of a sudden a huge number of commuters have started to do something we've been trying to get them to do for more than 20 years, which is to skip the commute, skip the congestion, skip the emissions, leave the car at home and work there. And all of a sudden they were doing it overnight. And while the circumstances behind the phenomenon are certainly terrible, it's easy to see the silver lining in the cloud. And especially if you're among the people that are still on the roadways and have to commute to and from work on a day-to-day basis. As we've also discovered, there are certain aspects of dealing in the virtual world that are much more difficult to navigate. This is particularly true when you consider how to best engage with your clients, with your communities, the public, when the time-tested methods like an open office door, a public meeting, an expo, or a fair have become either difficult or altogether impossible. The transportation improvements continue to go on despite the pandemic and despite other issues, which you may read about in the newspapers relating to PennDOT and funding. But also public engagement and input remain vital to all of the transportation projects. And this morning, you're going to learn some strategies for effective virtual engagement so that these virtual and vital inputs will continue despite all of the restrictions of COVID-19 that we're all dealing with. Now, if you've been to previous TMA Bucks events, you have heard me to compare us to public radio or public television. Our services and programs are available to everyone, but it is our members that make the operation possible. For those of you who are already TMA members, I sincerely thank each and every one of you for your continued support. You're helping us put federal money to work right here in Bucks County and on a day-to-day basis, making it a better place to live, work, and play. If you are not a member, I would invite you and I would be glad to assist you in considering joining today. Visit tmabucks.com. That is our website. Take some time to learn what we're all about. Feel free to contact me. You can contact any member of our very capable staff for more information, because as our membership grows, so the TMA grows. So help us to help you. And whether or not you're a member, visit tmabucks.com regularly. You'll get updates on projects, programs, and other information. So that's it for me. Before we go on, though, I want to invite Nicole to say a few words on behalf of our generous sponsor, the Automotive Training Center.
Thank you, Steve. So awesome that we're doing this Zoom seminar, because this is what my life is these days. We do Zoom presentations to our students in their classrooms or in their bedrooms, wherever they are, to tell them all about what we do here at Automotive Training Center. So we are a post-secondary technical school. We have two campuses, one in Exton, PA, and one in Warminster. I'm located in Warminster right now. And we're actually 103 years old. We started in 1917, crazy to think, as part of Spring Garden College. And a cool thing about us is we are family owned and operated. We're really proud about that. We are fully accredited. Our programs take 2 years for students to complete. So they come to us after high school. The only thing they need to come to ATC is a high school diploma. We have five programs that we offer: automotive, high performance, diesel, collision, and marine. And it's a great hands-on learning experience for students who are hands-on learners. The other thing about automotive these days is it's an essential field. Our students work part-time in the field, and as they're in school and during this pandemic, they have not stopped working. Their jobs have continued. We help every single student get a job part-time in the field while they're here at school. We think that's a great thing. And that leads to a 90% job placement rate after graduation. So a lot of those students who work part-time while they're here with us keep those jobs and they turn into their careers after they graduate from us. So it's a great opportunity to go right from high school to your training program to a career. There's so many jobs available in the automotive field these days. A lot of our older technicians are phasing out. There's so much technology associated with the automotive field these days that they just can't keep up, unfortunately, leaving lots of room for our younger workers to slip right in there. So that's about it. That's what I wanted to tell you about us here at ATC. We're really proud of what we do. Like we said, we're training automotive workers, and they're definitely essential in the world today. So thank you for having us, and enjoy the seminar.
All right. Thank you, Nicole. And I have to point out that the Automotive Training Center has been a member of TMA Bucks for well over a decade. So we are very grateful for your support. And McMahon has also been a member for actually longer than I've been with the TMA, which is 15 years. So thank you, gentlemen, as well. And without further ado, then, Eric, Bill, I will turn it over to you and enlighten our group this morning. Thank you.
Great. And thank you, Steve, for that great introduction, and to Nicole and ATC for sponsoring this today. I'm going to share my screen. So just want to make sure, can everyone see the presentation? Good. All right. I see nods. That's good. My name's Bill DeGuff-Roy. I have over 10 years of experience in transportation planning, and I've been in my current role as a transportation planner with McMahon for the last three. I work mostly with municipalities on active transportation plans, corridor studies, master plans and comprehensive plans, parking studies and grant applications. And today, I will be talking about some of the strategies that McMahon has found successful to engage communities in the planning process in light of the ever-evolving social distancing requirements. You can submit questions in the chat during the presentation, and I'll be able to answer those at the end. So, I hope that you come away from this presentation with a better understanding of the strategies for productive virtual meetings, the wide array of online public engagement tools that are available, the importance of online community engagement in the planning process, ways to collaborate virtually, and alternatives to the traditional public meeting. As we're all aware, the current COVID mitigation practices seem to change on an almost daily basis. I'm not a public health professional or an expert on what the current rules are. However, if you are planning a public outreach strategy for a project or even a one-time event, it's useful to check in with the resources that are available from the state or from the county or your local municipality. The state has a lot of general resources about what you should and shouldn't do. And the Department of Community and Economic Development has information that is specific to municipal government business. Now that we've been in this pandemic for a while, we're starting to plan public outreach efforts with virtual public engagement as the primary way we reach people at the outset of projects. We're building in time and expenses into project budgets that are different than what we have seen with traditional public outreach and public meetings. So I'm going to go into what some of those strategies are now. For virtual public meetings, these can have sort of mixed results. On one hand, more people may be able to attend than would have come to a public meeting in person. However, there's less of a time commitment in some cases, and the ability to multitask is removes some barrier to people. However, technology can be a barrier for other people. Additionally, keeping a public meeting running smoothly and efficiently while still getting the input that is required can be difficult. Some strategies that we have found successful include, and I'll go into each of these, but I should first give a caveat that McMahon uses Zoom. So there's other platforms out there that are likely have similar, if not the same functionalities. So I just wanted to let you know that We use Zoom for our meetings. Pre-registration. This gives organizers an idea of the number of people that will attend and can serve as a reminder and make sure people have the correct access credentials to get to the meeting. Another thing that you can do is mute attendees upon joining the meeting. No one wants to have to talk over people's kids or hear dogs barking in the background. So removing those distractions can be really useful for these virtual public meetings. Hand raising. We do want to get the valuable feedback from people that are participating. So the hand raising function or chat can be that opportunity. Just like in-person meeting, not everyone feels comfortable speaking during virtual meetings. So the poll questions give everyone a chance to have a say and can help us prioritize issues or strategies in our planning documents. Breakout rooms can be used to have a more intimate function. Thinking about traditional public open house meetings, there might be a group of three or four people talking to one project team member at a time and then moving to another person to talk to them about a different topic. So breakout rooms can kind of serve a similar function to that. Screen sharing. I think screen sharing is pretty self-explanatory. I'm doing screen sharing right now, showing you what my presentation on the screen. But a virtual whiteboard or the annotation function in Zoom allows people to write down their ideas and that can be recorded and captured for use in the plans. The next thing I want to talk about is online community engagement tools. There's a whole industry around online community engagement, and there's no way that I would be able to give a comprehensive overview here. The platforms that McMahon uses the most are called MindMixer, and we also, to some extent, use ArcGIS Online. Everyone's probably familiar with and participated in a standard survey. In this age of virtual public engagement, surveys have become even more useful tools in planning. However, now that people are online more, there are other ways to engage. Interactive maps allow people to place a point on a map and provide their comment about what an issue or what's something that they would like to see at a particular location. Photo contests can be an interesting tool where people can submit photos of concerns or of their favorite places in a community. Message boards can start a community conversation about particular topics. As I said, McMahon uses the MindMixer platform for this function. However, even a simple Facebook group can serve this purpose. Community outreach is no longer advertising a public meeting in the newspaper. Frankly, it hasn't been that for a while, even before COVID. However, the pandemic has given a sort of reality check for how people are getting their news. Having a social media presence is a good first step. However, gaining and engaging followers is a difficult task. You can't just have an account and casually post about upcoming meetings. That's just not enough. It truly requires a constant effort to keep people engaged. People read local news online. Knowing who to get press releases to and being available and willing to give interviews is very important. People are reading email more than ever. It's understandable to think that maybe avoiding email blasts as just more junk mail. But we've seen upticks in our online platform after we do send email blasts. So we definitely know people are reading those emails. Project websites or websites like the TMAs are a great way to give people the information about specific projects. However, it's important that the messaging is clear and consistent between sources. If you have the same project posted on a township website and on a project website, and there's a little bit of difference between the two, that can cause a lot of confusion among the public and among the people that you want to get feedback from. Of course, beware of internet trolls. Some of the most popular Facebook groups, while they'll reach the most people, are just full of people that are going to post negative things or just kind of make fun of whatever you put up there. So just be aware that internet trolls are out there. Virtual collaboration has been replaced with our standard project meetings. To ensure these meetings run smoothly and that you get done what you need to, it is important to keep some form of structure for these meetings. Distributing agendas and other materials ahead of the meeting gives people the chance to prepare for the meeting. You were likely doing this before COVID, and it's still important, if not more important now. People are busy now. They're likely trying to balance work with home life responsibilities at the same time. Sending prompt questions to your project team to think about before getting to the meeting improves the efficiency of the meeting. It's even easier for people to hide on video calls than in-person meetings. So I like to encourage or even require everyone on the call to speak. Calling on individuals to share their thoughts shows that you care about what they have to say. And just like virtual public meetings, take advantage of the technology. Use polls, breakout rooms, etc. And of course, people may be feeling isolated, so don't make it all about business. Connect with your project team and your coworkers about what's going on in their personal life. So some meeting alternatives. Relying solely on virtual engagement can be scary. There are some alternatives to in-person meetings that don't require people to be well-versed or have access to the latest technology. In some cases, limited attendance meetings or outdoor meetings where people can be spaced out more can work. However, I would encourage you to check with the current state, county, and local guidance before planning this type of event. We have seen some successful implementation of self-guided open houses where a meeting room would be set up with boards and maps as if it were a typical open house. However, there would be no project team member or staff member there for people to talk to. Instead, clear directions would be provided to guide people through the room, and participants would submit written input. This meeting could also be mirrored in an online engagement platform to get more input. We've been doing more and more project videos too. These can give a good overview of a project and can be posted online to give people project background information. Instead of needing to be on a video call at a specific time, people can watch the presentation at their leisure, then participate in any of the online engagement platforms that have been set up. The last thing I want to leave you with is know how to use the tools that you have to their fullest. You may have to practice virtual meetings, create a personal social media account if you don't already have one, and lean on the people that you know and trust. And with that, I want to thank TMA Bucks for inviting us to talk today, and thank ATC for sponsoring this event. I'm available for any questions if anyone submitted any in the chat, or you can raise your hand and we can call on you. and I will stop sharing now.
Take a few moments. If you had any questions, like I said, you can raise your hand or, well, I guess you'd have to be called on because you can't just unmute yourself in these meetings, so.
Yeah, I think Eric would have to call on the people if they raise their hands.
Well, I do have one question, and I don't know how to eloquently word this, but you did mention the internet trolls that come out when you post any kind of public information, and obviously that's pretty much anyone that's used the internet can encounter that. But in terms of virtual public engagement, and maybe the question's too premature to ask, but do you find, I've seen plenty of public meetings, especially in situations where the project has some controversy to it, where there, it can range from a couple of upset individuals all the way up to and including full community organization against a project. And just, I don't have to explain to you the acrimonious atmosphere that can happen in those situations. Do you find that in the virtual format, things tend to be more one-sided, a little more balanced, that the people that just show up to see some entertainment don't necessarily have the interest that they would in the virtual format, and so that the people that are there are really invested in the project and more interested in materials as opposed to just causing a problem?
I think I have seen more balance. Like you said, sometimes those people that are sort of against a project can be very loud and intimidating if it was like an in-person meeting. But being virtual, that kind of is evened out more, where you'll still get the people that that are not supportive of the project, but the people that are supportive feel safer in speaking up and saying that they do support a project. So
hiding behind the keyboard, in other words.
Yeah, it can be a good thing too.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Are there any specific examples coming up? If I missed it, I apologize. Are there any specific examples of meetings, at least relative to projects that you're working on, were coming up in the future that may be of interest or that people can check out just to see how the format works?
One project that is sort of ongoing right now that we're working on for Montgomery County Planning Commission is called Montco Pikes. And if you just Google Montco Pikes, you'll find the project page on Montgomery County's website. But there's a large online public input strategy for that. I don't know if there's any public meetings scheduled, but there's definitely the online Mind Mixer platform for that one.
Okay, another minute for more questions if anyone has some. But in the meantime, I will point out that one of the goals of these events that we've been working on are to keep them very short. We're looking forward in the near future when we can all meet in person again to perhaps having lunch and learn seminars where you literally in and out in less than an hour, you can come in, learn about a topic of interest, and then go on about your day. This is the sort of thing that we want to start offering to our members. We're really looking ahead to the types of information that we can offer to members going forward and building on that. As always, this is your TMA. If you have any suggestions, any recommendations, or you feel that you could offer something of interest to membership in the future, I invite you to contact me. Our email is right on the tmabucks.com website. We will post these seminars as they happen. We're looking to have one every couple of months, so pretty soon we'll be starting planning for something similar in March or February. Now, these will be more niche topics than you're accustomed to at our breakfast meetings. If you go to that, we're looking to target individual groups with something that perhaps wouldn't appeal to a broader audience. So that's just something to keep in mind as we're going forward. So as always, we will be recording these. I believe it is being recorded, right? And we'll be offering the video on our website as soon as that's available. So if you have somebody who couldn't be here today but might be interested in the material, certainly invite them to join us on our website and watch. I want to thank Nicole again and the Automotive Training Center for sponsoring us today. And of course, the fine work of the gentleman from McMahon for their presentation this morning. So unless there are other questions or other comments, this will conclude the presentation, and we'll look forward to seeing you very soon. Have a very safe and happy holiday, a very safe and happy new year, and we'll look forward to meeting with you again very soon.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Steve. Appreciate it.
A pleasure. Take care, everyone.